when someone is killed either by civilians or by police officers, we seek redress in the court system because that's the only thing we can do. And I respect that because I think that it's an important mood, particularly around healing. But that being said, I think it's very important that we recognize and realize that the system is broken. In fact, it's not just broken. I don't think it was ever meant to work on our behalf. The fact of the matter is that if we were to sit here and name all of the people, all of the black lives that have been killed by the police across this nation, and I would even go across this hemisphere, then we would have a list of thousands upon thousands upon thousands. And in the face of that kind of volume, we can only say that this is not an accident, but this is practice and par for the course. And if it is practice and it is par for the course, then we need to start to try to figure out how we can articulate it so that we can address it, right? Because in many ways, as we repeatedly go and try to figure out what went wrong, we sit up there and we often try to say, well, Officer so-and-so is just racist and a problem, or that judge is just racist and a problem, but it seems to me like the entire system is racist and a problem. And so where does that leave us? Where does that leave us? I think that that in many ways is why all of us are here in this room. We're here in this room because we recognize that a movement in order to ensure that black lives can continue to live is about healing and about calling out a system that refuses to acknowledge our humanity, right? It's about calling out a system that refuses to acknowledge our humanity. And for me, one of the many steps in doing that is recognizing the breadth and the depth of the violence that we are confronting. And so one of the things that I think is extremely important is to recognize that when the police kill, they don't just kill one body. They kill a community of bodies. Because the mothers, the sisters, the brothers, the fathers, the cousins, the aunties, the friends that must live after somebody has been killed are resigned to a living death. And that is not a life at all. I think about the open letter that Sabrina Fulton wrote to Leslie McFadden after Michael Brown was killed, Sabrina Fulton being the mother of Trayvon Martin. And one of the really devastating things that she said was, "Welcome to the club that none of us wants to be in, the club where all of us have to deal with the fact that our killer still walks around, sometimes on paid administrative leave, sometimes posting pictures of our children's dead bodies on Twitter, as it just happened this past week." And so one of the things that I think we have to start to think about is how we can talk about and articulate this violence as a violence against our community. This is a political violence that's directed not just to black men, but it's a violence that is directed towards all black families, a black collective. And yes, all lives matter, quote unquote, but the fact of the matter is, black lives are in crisis, and black lives need to be addressed right now. Because if we don't begin to address these issues and collectively do so as a moral responsibility as a society, then what we are going to have on our hands is a genocide of such proportions that we will not even be able to understand and account for the bodies that have collected. And the fact of the matter is, we already have a genocide of that proportion. But we just don't realize that that's what's going on because it is slowly taking place. And so, you know, I don't want to say a whole lot. There's a lot that I can say because I feel like this is a really important issue. But what I will say in this, and then I'll stop talking. I believe that we collectively, as a community, have got to come together in order to heal, in order to heal one another, in order to take care of one another, in order to acknowledge and recognize the way that one death also affects all of us. But we also need to come together in solidarity in order to call attention, either call our society to task on the fact that this particular system is a system that we have got to dismantle and change. We cannot continue in this fashion. We cannot continue to think that we are going to give petitions or sign or change laws or put body cameras on police officers and that's going to somehow stop killing. Because the fact of the matter is, the system is rotten. And what do you do with a rotten structure? You don't paint over it and continue to live in it. You figure out a new way to rebuild.
Thank you. right now, we're here because society, or some of society, should I say, not all, believes in black lives is not matter. They don't care about justice, about right or wrong. I myself believe that integrity is where we all should be raised. What we should be taught is not your skin color, it's not your status in society, it's not where you come from. But, you know, and that's in a perfect world, and we're not in that world right now. I realize that. You know, we're in a world right now that, you know, if you don't have the capital, you're going to get the punishment. Not the right skin color, you're gonna be guilty before, you know, proven innocent. You're guilty, y'all. You know what I mean? Not innocent before proven, you know what I mean? And that's the world that we live in. You know, I'm supposed to talk about riding skates, but I feel that I need to talk about what's on my heart tonight. And my heart tells me that in order to solve the problem, we have to get to not to segregate police lives matter, black lives matter, white lives matter, it's about all lives matter. It's about us coming together as a community, working together to make a change. Because that's the only way it's going to be done. You know, we as a black people can stand up and push our issue forward, which I truly support. But that's only going to solve part of the problem. It's not going to solve the whole problem. After we clear that up, then we're going to focus on some other race, some other creed, some other, you know what I mean? It's about everybody, you know? I say that because that's where I was raised and that's what I believe. A lot of people don't share my same opinion. And that's something you got to do. Everybody got to walk on the wall. But I do know that it has to be a starting point. And Black Lives Matter is a starting point. We got to start here. We're not in here. Because in the end, it's not about just black and white. It's not just about all lives. But we got to start somewhere. And this is the perfect point to start. Because we're at the bottom of the totem pole. We don't want to be drugged. We don't want to be beaten and tortured and being, you know, racial profiled and, you know what I mean? But we should not let that make us bitter, let that make us better. Let us stand up together. Yeah, y'all, whomever, did what you did. That's not going to make me have prejudice or think ill of every other person in that room, you know what I mean? Because everybody's not like that. Because my brother would be still breathing today if it wasn't for white, black, Mexican, and everybody, all you people out there. You know what I'm talking about? We all came together to help prevent this death and have a stay. And by us all doing that, we got to step, take another step even further. You know what I mean? But we're here tonight about Black Lives Matter. That's the starting point. You know, today. Today is the first day of the rest of our lives.
Okay.
What are we going to do from here? How are we going to act? How are we going to treat each other? You know, that's what matters. That's what matters. You know? My family, speaking in the story of my family right now, we have been through almost 20 years of a nightmare we can't wake up.
Mm-hmm.